Good morning. Peace, greetings, and welcome wherever you come from, whatever you look like, whoever you love, wherever you are in your spiritual journeys, wherever you happen to be worshiping today, know that you're all so very warmly welcome in this time and in these places. In the top of your bulletin, there's a poem there from one of my favorite poets, Rainer Maria Rilke, from the late 19th, early 20th century, and I found this poem the other day, "Let Everything Happen to You. Beauty and terror just keep going. No feeling is final." That first line, I wrestle with that, "Let everything happen to you." It sounds so passive, but I don't think that's what he's talking about. I think he's saying that as things happen to you in this life, beauty and terror just keep going. No feeling is final. So whatever's happening in your life, whatever beauty and terror you're experiencing, just keep going into this time of worship today, into the loving arms of our loving God. Welcome to worship. I'm excited to say that today we welcome the Bolin family and Josie Bolin, who will be baptized in just a little while. And it's a big moment, and so we welcome you, welcome Josie and your whole family. We're excited to celebrate this with you. Baptism is about many things, but one of the things it is, it's about following the Prince of Peace as we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, the peacemaker. And so we pause today on this morning of baptism. We light the candle of peace. We recommit and reroute ourselves in the way of peace. And we're reminded that every raindrop, every drink of water, every drop from the shower is a reminder of our baptisms and about the way of peace. Singing helps us with that too.
Thank you.
eyes and body or spirit as you're able as we pray together. Saying word and water, sound and silence, presence and transcendence, us in God and prayer. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Save us in the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to join us in singing hymn 307, Wonder of Wonders. I'm excited to invite Josie and your family forward. Welcome, welcome.
Perfect, perfect.
Is that everyone you want to hear? Godparents as well.
There's
plenty of room for awe. I'm going to sneak out here. There we
yes,
go.
Yes, sorry, yes.
Well, we gather here on this blessed day in this sacred place to baptize Josie Boleyn. We come to affirm her as a beloved child of God, to welcome her into the Christian family through this act, and to recommit ourselves to being a community where she can find nurture and spiritual guidance throughout her life.
As Josie is baptized, those of us who surround her as family, friends, and as a community of faith must offer ourselves as the instruments of the love that is made visible through this sacrament. Therefore, we make pledges to one another and to God. So do you, Katie and Andy, desire to have Josie baptized into the family of Jesus Christ?
We do.
Do you desire for her to know the love of God that is freely given for her, to be nurtured in her life of faith by the people who surround you today?
We do.
Do you promise, Katie and Andy, according to the grace given to you, to grow with Josie in your own faith, so that through you, she may learn to be attentive and responsive to God in her life, living out the love embodied by Jesus Christ? Elizabeth and Evan.
Uh-oh.
As Josie's godparents, do you promise to support and love her, guiding her as best you are able to live a life of faith, service, and love as Jesus so lived and taught?
In the congregation, I invite you, as you're able, to rise. And I ask you this, do you who witness this sacrament welcome Josie into the Christian fold through this church community? Do you promise to be a community to which her whole family can turn in times of need and joy? And do you promise to love, support, and care for Josie as she lives and grows in Christ?
We promise to love, support, and care.
We commit with God and with one another. And do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all God's ways, ever watchful for how God's blessed word of truth shall be revealed unto us. Please be seated.
Let us pray. By your Holy Spirit, gracious God, this water, and by your Holy Spirit, save those who confess the name of Jesus Christ, that sin may have no power over them. Create new life this day in Josie, that she may rise with glory. Glory to you, eternal God, the one who was and is and always shall be, world without end.
You can come with Mom if you want. And so, Josie, we baptize you in the name of the Creator Christ.
And of the living God.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Josie, may the Holy Spirit be upon you.
Child of God,
disciple of Christ,
and member of the church.
Welcome.
Welcome.
As a deacon in the church, as a deacon in the Shalott Congregational Church, I welcome Josie into the Christian fold on behalf of our community. She has a home here with us. Please know that we will do our best to offer a place where she can hear the stories of faith, experience the love of Christ, and be encouraged in her relationship with God. May you be reminded, Katie and Andy, that through this sacrament, Josie comes from God through you as a gift of grace to the world. We are grateful that she will grow with us. May God bless your parenting of her, and as she blesses your lives. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Gracious God, you have filled the world with joy by giving us the gift of Christ. So bless Josie. May she be filled with joy. May she never be ashamed to confess a faith in you. Bless Katie and Andy, and may they always show their gratitude for the life you have given by loving and caring for Josie. Bless her sisters, Reagan and Willa. Bless these, your faithful people. Unite them in the peace of Christ and the company of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we get to sing to Josie, where she will, with her sisters, if she's willing, to walk around and say hello to you as you say hello to her.
Such a great job. Well done. We have a card for you. You can give it, you can share it with your parents. But we also have this little cross that you can hold in your hand just like this, okay? It's very soft and smooth, and it represents the cross from church, which we talk about in Sunday school. So this is for you. Yes, perfect. That's perfect. And this is for you and your parents. Good job today.
And also with you.
Go with peace and love in your hearts.
You bet. Thank you. And now, children and youth are all invited to Sunday school.
Good morning, everyone. As we settle into our time of prayer, I ask you to just be still for a moment, and though you might have not have thought of a prayer you'd like to raise, is there something on your hearts? Is there someone for whom you would like special prayers this morning? Yes, Peg. So for Peg's sister, Sally, who had heart surgery this past week, it was a 7-hour surgery. It was more complicated than expected. They didn't finish it. So she remains intubated and will have further surgery tomorrow on Monday. So prayers for her and for your whole family. Anyone else? Yes, Randy. So Randy and Janie want to give thanks for the prayers that we offered last week for their new granddaughter, Sloane, who was born a week ago, and she had a difficult birth. She has been in the ICU and the NICU, and it's still not as perfect as it should be, but they hope that she will come home
this week, which will give everyone a little bit of peace in their hearts. So thank you. Yes.
To a Wayne Robin friend, Joan Madison, who is recovering and through a very slow process of getting over some medical problems.
Fran Joan Madison, who is recovering at Wake Robin, but has had some very difficult medical issues. Yes, Jack.
I just want to say some prayers of thanks. I had a lot of life experience this Labor Day weekend when I was admitted to UVM Medical Center, having passed out three times and fallen to the floor. They put me on a cardiac monitor on Sunday when I was admitted. And Monday, Labor Day, while I was talking to my nurse, I went into full cardiac arrest. And they coded me. And for 17 and a half seconds, I had a flat line, no pulse, no heartbeat. And it only takes 6 seconds without a heartbeat, and you pass out. So the next morning, they put in a pacemaker, and I no longer will have those events. If my heart goes below 70, it'll kick in and start my heart going. So I'm so lucky to have such a wonderful medical center. And Kevin came by and gave a prayer the day after surgery. For Roberta and myself, that was so special. It brought tears to my eyes. And the next day, Kevin put his hand on my head and blessed me. I think he got a lot of experience a couple weeks before. But anyway, I am really, truly blessed for the Medical Center and for such a wonderful team here in this church. I'm truly thankful.
So Bobby and Jack have had a rough couple of weeks. Jack wants to give thanks for life. Thanks for being here. He has had some very serious heart issues. He had what he calls an out-of-life experience where his heart stopped for 17 seconds. He was at UVM. He's had a pacemaker put in. He is now better and so grateful for Kevin's ministry to him and laying hands on him. All of that aside, right now, I just want to give thanks to God for seeing you sitting in that pew right now. Yes, Kevin.
Just a celebration for the 20th wedding anniversary of Matt and Hadley.
Ooh. Anyone else? Susan, where's Susan? Oh, yes, Andy.
Prayers of gratitude and thanks to the community for welcoming Josie to the church.
From Andy, prayers of gratitude and thanks for welcoming Josie into the fold of this wonderful community. I have a prayer. Yes, go, Cameron.
Prayers for Reverend Russell Willis at United Church of Colchester. He's getting a pacemaker replaced next week.
Oh, so prayers for Reverend Willis, who is going, the United Church of Williston, who is going to have a what?
United Church of Colchester.
United Church of Colchester, who is going to have a pacemaker put in next week. I want to ask for prayers for our niece, Emily Tunstall. Emily lives in Myrtle Beach, California, and on Friday night, she had knocking on her door a neighbor and partner who were in crisis. One of them had been shot, and Emily let them into the house and shut the door. The shooter pursued them, shot through the door, and shot Emily in the leg. Emily is doing well. She had a long surgery and is in the hospital still. Her family's gathered around. But it's a shocking thing these guns. And I guess it takes something like that to really just rattle you. Emily is so grateful for prayers. I told her that we were praying for her this morning and for Charlie's sister. So thank you for prayers for Emily. So let us pray. Dear God, September is summer's Sabbath. Sucked to school and work, the people left, lightening the press for perfect weather, for rain, but only at night, for warmth, but no heat, for paddling waters, wind for sails, shade, breeze, and no mosquitoes, please. This could drive a poor summer to exhaustion, staring July and August in the eye with demands and expectation wears a season out. No one relaxes in the face of high expectation. September arrives so summer can relax, pick its teeth with a stalk of straw, swing gently in the hammock, enjoy the harvest so diligently tended. Help us, dear Lord, to find the Sabbath calm that when the winds howl and our fingers freeze and ice coats road and soul, we might recall that 1 hour in September when we saw summer rest and laid our head upon her breast. Amen.
As we come to our time of offering, I'm reminded of my experience last night. Hadley and me, we took three of our youth to the Salvation Army to serve dinner, as this church does about five times a year. And we had this amazing group of young people who, without complaining or whining, swept and took out the garbage and prepared fruit and served with a smile on their face a very broad cross-section of the folks living on the streets of Burlington. I think there were about 55 meals that were served. And the folks from the street who came in were so grateful. And one fellow in particular, on his way out, stopped by and said to me, "I just want to thank you for your great hospitality tonight." So I think about so much in my life and the life of the church, maybe your life too, that we think about all that we don't have. And there was this sign at the Salvation Army last night that said, maybe sometimes stop asking God for things and just give thanks for all of the abundance that you have. So anyway, that sign with the youth showing the way and just showing how much they have to give and serve, I was just rooted in this great sense that there's enough, that there's a more than enough resources to go around. I'm so grateful for that. And it's out of my gratitude for the rich, deep abundance that God showers down upon us all the time, that I give and that our young people give too. With that, let's pray. Loving God, thank you for enough. Thank you for having enough to give back. Thank you for our money, but also thank you for our time and our hearts of service. Help us to continue to give and give over and over again for the good of us all. Amen.
Thank you. chapters 3, verses 1 through 12, James warns of the power and the dangers of our mouths. Let us listen together. Excuse me. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will face stricter judgment. For all of us make mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is mature, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships, though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, yet they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of life, and is itself on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame a tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless God, and with it we curse people made in God's likeness. From the same mouth comes a blessing and a cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. May God bless this reading in our hearing. Amen.
There we go. James knew the power of the tongue. The string of metaphors. The tongue is like a small bridle that steers the whole horse. A tongue is like a rudder that steers the whole ship. Or the tongue is a fire, James tongue succinctly. So after this string of metaphors, James goes on to observe later on in our passage today how we have this tendency as human beings to use our tongues to both bless God and sometimes to curse our neighbors who are made in the image of God. The point there is that there's a duality to our language, our tongues, the way we use them. that we bless and we curse, we encourage and we discourage, we heal and we wound. And the easiness with which we vacillate back and forth, well, that's why our tongues are fire. Let's pray. Loving God, we rest our tongues for a moment. We still our hearts and our bodies. We take a deep breath, asking to be open to the word today. Give us the gospel this morning, God, and nothing less. Amen. So I'm a preacher. I also a person in my life and ministry. I go to a whole lot of meetings, and I end up saying a whole lot of things throughout my week and throughout my life. Maybe many of you are like that as well. And I'm mindful that sometimes when I speak, that my tongue is fire that sometimes burns. Deirdre can attest to the fact. My kids can attest to that fact. Many in this room can attest to that fact, that sometimes I give ouch moments with the words of my mouth. Sometimes I say unhelpful or uncomfortable things. And so I know that my tongue is fire, and I also know that that's not my intention, right? I try as I go about through my life to be somebody who encourages, who blesses, and who lifts people up. So there's a tension in within me. And I have tried over the course of my life more and more as I get older to be somebody who can tend the fire of my fiery tongue in a way that blesses and encourages and wounds rather than something less. So what I'd like to do this morning is pretty straightforward. I'd just like to share with you a couple of tools that I've learned in my life to help me tend the fire of my fiery tongue, just in case you have a fiery tongue and might use some of those tools as well. So first, a tool that I have learned to tend my fire is by setting my intentions. Sounds a little new agey, but I think it's also quite biblical and just part of what it means to be human, that as I go about my day, as I jump into meetings, as I prepare to preach, as I go home to see my family, as I interact with friends and neighbors and members of the congregation, that I take a second, just a split second, to say that when this interaction is done, when this sermon is over, God, may it be a blessing and an encouragement and healing rather than something. Setting intentions isn't a magic pill. It's not going to mean that it's just because I intend to do something that I'm not going to harm people along the way. But setting intentions is important because we go about our lives so briskly. We're always moving from one thing to the next. And sometimes when we get into these interactions and conversations and meetings and speeches, that our real agenda might not even be, we might not even be conscious of our real agendas. We might want to get into this interaction to get our way, or to win an argument, or just to check something off the list, or just to be done with this darn meeting so I can move on to something else. Sometimes our real agenda makes it so that we hurt people even when we don't mean to do that. So by simply setting an intention to say that when this conversation, this meeting, this sermon is done, God, please make it be the point of love and light for those around me. So I begin my sermons as an example, and I often pray and say something like, God, give us the gospel and nothing less, a way of setting my intention for that. Another tool for tending the fire of my fiery tongue is not only setting my intention, but something else that James teaches us back in chapter 1 of his letter, to be those who are quick to listen and slow to speak. This is a real challenge for me. It is. I'm often exactly the opposite of this. I think many of us are, but it's such a simple thing, right? To just be those who just take a second to read the room, to read the Zoom room, to ask, what's really being said here, verbally and non-verbally? What are the needs of this time? What did that person intend by that? To listen deeply so that we can gain a deeper sense of where we're at and where the other person or people are at and what's the sort of overall zeitgeist in the room. And so when we enter into that situation with our language, that we increase our chances of having our words land in such a way that are encouragement and healing and blessing. Ancient Greek philosopher Epictetus, I think is how you say his name, he said it so perfectly. He said, "We have two ears and one mouth to remind us to listen twice as much as we speak." Another tool I've learned for tending the fire of my fiery tongue is practicing the fine art of action, reflection, action. As I said, life comes at us so quickly, right? We're always moving from one thing to the next. There's demands and demands and demands. And we often do things and say things, but we don't always take the time afterwards to reflect back on how what we did and what we said, how that landed and impacted other people, right? So it's a simple thing to just go away from a meeting or a conversation or an interaction and just say, did that come across the way that I wanted that to come across? Did what I say really lead to the place that I was hoping that it would lead? Do I need to call somebody up after the fact and ask for clarification or to clarify what I said or to ask forgiveness or to ask somebody else to be forgiven? So this art of action, reflection, action, of just taking the time to reflect, and I'm not suggesting that we live our lives, you know, neurotically all the time, second-guessing ourselves all the time, waking up at 3 or 4 in the morning going, boy, I can't believe I said that or didn't say that in that meeting the night before. But just to make it a practice, to make it a habit of doing, reflecting on it, and then modifying our language and our behavior after the fact to make sure that we are love and light in this world. So lastly, this morning, a tool for tending the fire of our fiery tongues is to establish a circle of accountability, which sounds complicated, it sounds time-consuming, but it's really simple, right? We have people in our lives who know us, who we know, and who can speak the truth in love to us, right? So we can just go to those people and just say, you know, keep an ear out, keep an eye out. Let me know if what I'm doing and what I'm saying, let me know if that crosses a boundary or a border or if that's unhelpful in some way. So Reverend Susan and Reverend Hadley are a big part of my circle of accountability. And on a number of occasions, I've just gone to them and said, you know, please just keep an eye on me to make sure that I'm functioning in a healthy and a professional way that is Christ-like to those around me. And they will be quick to tell me when they think I'm not. I've got friends and family and certainly Deirdre and my kids and many members of this congregation who I trust, and they trust me, and we know that we can go to one another and just speak that truth and love to make sure that what we're doing is helpful and good and right. I have a tongue of fire, and I know that sometimes it burns. And so I try as I go to have a circle of accountability, to be quick to listen and slow to speak, to practice the fine art of action, reflection, and action. And what was the first one? I forgot. See? What did I say? Setting intentions. Wonderful. Someone's been quick to listen. So my tongue is fire, and maybe your tongue is fire too. Maybe some of these tools will be helpful in your life. I'll end with this. I would be remiss in a sermon like this not to give some specific attention to our electronic tongues, right? We all know that we have a whole wide variety of electronic tools available to us. We have X and Insta and Facebook and TikTok and email and texts and Front Porch Forum. Front Porch Forum is often very helpful. That's sort of a local email listserv that we have, and people post all kind of things. It's often helpful. It's often really toxic, though, right? And we fight about things like speed limits on Ferry Road and the trees and the town plan. And I often wonder to myself, you know, would that person really have said that if the other person was sitting in their room looking at their face? I often wonder, would they really have said that if they hadn't had their second glass of wine sitting on the couch on their laptop, right? So it's almost like it's, you know, it's our God-given right to say whatever the heck we want to say as long as it's front of a screen in some sort of anonymous text box. But the problem is that our electronic tongues burn as hotly as our real tongues, and sometimes even more so. So to add to the tools for tending our fiery tongues, I will just say this, that electronic cursing is still cursing, that electronic discouragement is still discouragement, and that when you wound somebody electronically, they are still wounded. So that's what I have today. Enough from my fiery tongue. Grace and peace and encouragement and blessing and healing and love and light in you and out through your mouth always. Amen. Closing hymn is number 493. Another exciting Sunday here in the life of the church. Certainly we welcome all to join the Bolin family and Josie after the service over in Coffee Fellowship, where they're hosting a special spread. And again this week, I'm not going to spoil any surprises, but it's worth going over there. So Bob just, cider donuts and other things. Thank you. And then you can hang around for a bit and then maybe go home, and then you come back at 4 o'clock where our own Claudia Marshall and friends will be hosting a wonderful concert here, a benefit concert for the Turning Point Center in Burlington. It's a free concert, but donations will be welcome. And we did a sound check yesterday, and she's worth coming out to hear. You knew that, but please do. It'll be a wonderful event, and thank you for your time and energy putting it together. Let's see. This coming Tuesday at 6 o'clock, we have a very exciting event, which is really relevant to the sermon today. It's about civil discourse, right? How to speak civilly to one another as we head into election season. That's probably really, really important. That'll be co-sponsored by the church and the Shalott Library. It'll be 6 o'clock this Tuesday. It's led by Susan Clark of the League of Women Voters. There'll be some sort of presentation and then also some small breakout groups where we learn about and practice our civil discourse. I think it would be helpful to sign up in advance, which you can do through the library's website, or just come talk to me and I'll get you connected in. Next week, September 22nd, I'll be preaching again, but we're going to take some time to think together about the circle of care. This is a program that was started by Sandy Riggs, maybe 10, 12 years ago or more, as a way of inviting you all in the congregation to circle around one another and to support one another through meals and rides and in other ways as well. So the deacons have been working for quite a while to sort of reinvigorate that program. We want to give thanks to those who have served in the past, but we're kind of starting our lists over and inviting everybody to sort of repopulate that list, to be on a call list, to come and to help circle up. Being on the list doesn't mean that you have to do everything all the time. It just means you're one among many who can help out from time to time. Our own Jordan Blucher will be helping us to organize rides, and our Lynn Fox will be helping us to organize food. And anyway, come next week, we'll talk a little bit more about it and relaunch our important Circle of Care program. Lastly, I just want to mention that after the service next week, we will have an introductory session for those interested in membership. We just had two new member classes join over the last couple of months, including last Sunday. But we're studying that again. There's quite a few folks who are interested, and so coming to that after church, it'll be 45 minutes, it'll be no obligations, no commitments, just finding out a little bit more about this crazy group of people and all the things that we're doing together. That's what I have. Other news or announcements today? Well, friends, then let's stand. Receive this blessing. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you always with kindness and grant you peace. Go in peace. But first, turn to one another. Turn to those at home and sing. May the